गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर योगेश सरोदे ऑफ जीवन विकास महाविद्यालय देवग्राम। आई हार्टी वेलकम यू ऑल इन दिस सेशन। टुडे वी विल लर्न द पोयम द हाईवे मैन बाय अल्फ्रेड नोएस। इन द अर्लियर पार्ट वी हैड सीन द सेंट्रल आइडिया अबाउट द पोएट, थीम ऑफ द पोयम एंड ऑल्सो कैरिड आउट अ रीडिंग ऑफ द पोयम। Now, in this session, we will see the comprehension part of the poem. We know that this poem, The Highwayman, is composed of three parts. In the first part, we have six stanza, each of six lines. In the second part, we have nine stanzas. And in the third part, we have two stanza. So we'll see the comprehension of that. Noyes makes use of several poetic techniques in The Highwayman. These include are not limited to alliteration, metaphor and enjambment. The first alliteration occurs when words are used in succession or at least appear close together and begin with the same sound. This technique appears numerous times throughout the poem. For example, landlord, leaped and love in the last lines of stanza 3 of part 1. Metaphor is a comparison between two unlike things that does not use like or as, is also present in the text. When using this technique, a poet is saying that one thing is another thing. They are not just similar. Noyes uses three in the first stanza of The Highwayman. He compares the moon and wind to the sea and the road to a ribbon of moonlight. Another important technique commonly used in poetry is enjambment. It occurs when a line is cut off before its natural stopping point. Enjambment forces a reader down to the next line and the next line quickly. One has to move forward in order to comfortably resolve a phrase or sentence. For example, the transition between lines 1 and two of the fourth stanza of part 1. So these are the various situation as far as literary devices are concerned. We will see stanza wise comprehension of the poem. See the first stanza of part 1. The wind was a torrent of darkness among the gusty trees. The highwayman came riding up to the old inn door. Now, in the first stanza of The Highwayman, the speaker begins by describing the wind, the moon, and the road. Noyes uses metaphors to outline what each of these is like. The wind is a torrent of darkness, alluding to the movements of a river or other powerful moving body of water. In the second line, he compares the moon to a ghostly galleon that appears like a galleon or a very large ship that is being tossed upon the clouds. This brings the image of water into the poem again. The third metaphor compares the road to a ribbon of moonlight that is running over the purple moor. The road is an important part of the poem that plays a major role later on. It appears shining in among the previous darker images. Along the road comes the main character of the poem, the highwayman. Noyes uses here repetition to emphasize the movement of the man and his horse. He's riding. He comes all the way up to the inn. So this is what is the understanding of the first stanza. Now stanza 2. He had a French cocked hat on his forehead, a bunch of lace at his chin. And last line, his rapier hilt a twinkle under the jeweled sky. In the second stanza, the description of the highwayman begins. He has a French cocked hat on his forehead and a bunch of lace at his chin. Now, these phrases refer to his fancy clothes and the lace that is poking out from the top of his shirt. There are no wrinkles, nor could there even be in his pants, and he has a jeweled twinkle about him. He is shining with importance. The word twinkle is used 3 times in the last 3 lines to describe his pistol, rapier and general aspect. Now third stanza, over the cobbles he clattered and clashed in the dark in air, planting a dark red love knot into her long black hair. Noyes makes use of alliteration in the first line of the third stanza in order to mimic the sound of the highwayman's movements over the cobblestones. He taps on the shutters, but there is no answer. Everything is locked and barred. Instead, he decides to whistle, and luckily for him, the landlord's black-eyed daughter, that is Bess, shows up. She is braiding her hair and she comes out to see him. There is a dark red love knot in her hair that is added in a symbol of her love and the relationship to the man. Now, the fourth stanza of part one. And dark in the dark old inn yard, a stable wicket creaked. Dumb as a dog, he listened and he heard the robber say. The fourth stanza introduces the third character into the poem. Tim the ostler. He's the man who takes care of the horses and he's listening to the meeting. He has a white face, eyes that make him appear insane or mad, and hair like moldy hay. This is just one example of the powerful imagery that Noyes makes use of throughout his poem. He, like the highwayman, loves the daughter of the landlord. He listened, eavesdropping on what the two talk about. There is a great contrast drawn between the lovely daughter, the fancy and confident highwayman, and Tim. Now see, fifth stanza. One kiss, my bony sweetheart, I am after a prize tonight. I will come to thee by moonlight, though hail should bar the way. The second to last stanza of this section of the poem contains the words of the highwayman. He is going to go after a prize tonight. This means that he has some robbing that he plans on accomplishing that night, and then he would be back with the sunrise. His actions and life are clearly romanticized by the poet. The highwayman knows and tells Bess, that Lord's daughter, that the law might press and follow him through the day and the night. If this is the case, then he is going to wait until night to come and see her again. But he is determined, even if hail should bar the way, to get there. No matter what, he would come back. Sixth stanza. He rose upright in the stirrups. He scarce could reach her hand. Then he tugged at his rein in the moonlight and galloped away to the west. The sixth stanza describes his action once more. He tries to reach up and touch her, and he can just barely. The two are separated by their distance, but come together through their mutual love. She lets down her hair, and he blushes at the scent of her. He kisses her hair in the darkness of the night. See, the word moonlight is used three lines in the stanza. Emphasis is there on light, but also darkness also. It helps to create a specific atmosphere for these events to play out in. The last line describes him riding off to the west in order to accomplish what he needs to. He goes into the west, not a good symbol for one who wants to come back. The west is often used to represent death. And the afterlife is that is the direction in which the sun sets. Now here in this first part. Now second part, stanza 1. He did not come in the dawning. He did not come at noon. King George's men came marching up to the old inn door. The second section of The Highwayman begins with the statement, he did not come in the dawning. When the sun rose, he wasn't there as he intended to be, nor was he there at noon or at the setting of the sun. This is not a good sign, especially considering the determination he showed in the previous stanzas. The speaker notices that rather than the highwayman come up the road, he sees a red coat troop marching. They resemble a gypsy ribbon of red coming across the moor. They are King George's men and come right up to the old inn door. Now stanza 2. They said no word to the landlord. They drank his ale instead, for Bess could see through her casement the road that he would ride. The men do not talk to the landlord as they probably should, but they do drink his ale, wine. They gagged his daughter and bound her to the narrow bed. These are the villains of the story, men who are certainly going to throw a wrench in the happy relationship that played out in the previous stanzas. The men are setting up an ambush, waiting for the highwayman to return. There is hell at every window, meaning that from any the highwayman could be shot and killed. Terribly, Bess can see out a window the exact spot her lover will return. Now, stanza 3. They had tied her up to attention with many a sniggering jest. I shall come to thee by moonlight, though hell should bar the way. The men snigger and joke as they do their job. They are pleased with themselves and cruel taunt with young woman. Bess' mind is on her doomed man, who recalls saying, "Watch for me by moonlight." She knows that he could come at any moment. Now, fourth stanza of part 2. Sweet stayed her hands behind her, but all the knots held good. The tip of one finger touched it, the trigger at last was hers. Now in the fourth stanza, the narrator describes how Bess tries to twist her hand out of the ropes. She struggles, but she does not get free. Rather than escape from the room, she decides she is going to reach for a gun. The trigger at least was hers. The last line declares. Now in the fifth stanza, the tip of one finger touched it. She strove no more for the rest, and the blood of her veins in the moonlight throbbed to her love's refrain. Bess gets up, has the gun, and has it pressed to the breast. She moves as quietly as possible, trying to keep the men from hearing her. She would not strive again. The third line says, Noes repeats the word moonlight three times again in this stanza. There is also a good example of alliteration with the repetition of words beginning with a sound B. There is a focus in the last lines on the beating of Beth's heart and the blood in her veins. Now see, sixth stanza of part two. Clot, 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 had they heard it, the horse hoofs ringing clear, the red coats looked to the priming, she stood up straight and still. In the sixth stanza, there is a sound of horse hoofs ringing clear. They are coming up the path from the distance, just as Beth and the soldiers predicted. But it does not appear that the soldiers realize what the sound is. The highwayman is riding up the road again, just as he did in the first stanzas. There is again an emphasis on the word riding. Finally, the redcoats realize what was happening. Beth is prepared to put into action her plan. Now see in seventh stanza. Clot, clot, in the frosty silence. Clot, clot, in the echoing night. Shattered her breast in the moonlight and warned him with her death. The tension is building in these lines as the poem reaches its climax. Still, it is unclear what Beth is trying to do. It is in the last lines of this stanza that becomes clear. She decides to shoot herself in the breast in order to warn him with her death. This is the action of a very desperate person. Now stanza 8 of second part. He turned, he spurred to the west. He did not know who stood, had watched for her love in the moonlight and died in the darkness there. It was at the sound of the gunshot that he runs back to the west from which he came. He does not know what it was. But the narrator does, and the scene is gruesome. It was the next day that he heard what had happened. His face grew grey to hear that his lover had died. Now see ninth stanza of part two. Stanza 9. Back he spurred like a madman, shrieking a curse to the sky. And he lay in his blood on the highway with a bunch of lace at his throat. The highwayman goes back to the inn the next day after hearing what happened to Beth. He is terribly angry and feels as though he should take revenge. He rides and curses the sky. The highwayman also has his sword at the ready, prepared to kill the redcoats that caused her death. The highwayman, as one might expect, is killed by the soldiers at the inn. He goes down like a dog on the highway. The fight lay stunned straight at his throat. First stanza of part 3. And still of a winter night, they say, when the wind is in the trees, a highwayman comes riding up to the old inn door. The last two stanzas of the poem are in italics, symbolizing that they come after the main events outlined in part 1 and part 2. These lines describe how, after the events of the poem, that the ghost of the two lovers still reappear around the inn. When the wind is in the trees and the environment is in the right state, as it was at the beginning of the poem, the highwayman comes back as he used to. And the last stanza, means second stanza of part 3, over the cobbles he clatters and clangs in the dark inn yard, plaiting a dark red love knot into her long black hair. Just like in the past, when the two were alive, he tries to get into the inn. Now, these lines are almost word for word those that came at the beginning of the poem. बेस इज देयर जस्ट एज सी यूज टू बी एक्सेप्ट नाउ दे आर बोथ डेड. दिस इज ए होपफुल एंड वार्म इमेज एंड द एंड ऑफ द पोएम. सो फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज व्हाट इज द कॉम्प्रेंशन पार्ट ऑफ द पोएम. आई होप यू definitely might have understood the poem because it's a long narrative poem in the form of narration like story. So I hope you will get it by heart. So in the next session we will see some important aspects and literary devices in the poem also. So thank you today. Good day.